Welcome back to another episode of Monday Madness. Let's quickly get straight into it. Most of these trades were called on the Monday Madness video. So if you haven't checked it out, this Supply Sunday video last week as well. I hope you guys checked out. The OGSD sell was called, the Euroord buy was called, everything was obviously called in the Supply Sunday video. So let's quickly recap on how you could have entered, how you could have capitalized on the move. So starting with OGSD, the first thing obviously you need to do is go to the higher time frames. And we saw that perfect evening star formation on the daily time frame. So that alone obviously said to us, okay, well, we are looking for sells. Same thing there, we had that move and a pullback today, then a sell. Had that move, then a pullback, and then we're looking for a sell. So we already knew the bias we're looking at. Okay, also on a daily time frame, price broke structure to the downside and we were waiting for a pullback and for a sell. Then we had a push to this area of demand over here and we had a pullback. Then market went, had a big sell off to the downside. So now we had to get a little bit smarter with this trade. So what I did was obviously seeing that price is pushing down. And now we're waiting for a pullback. So all I did was, number one, you could actually just add that area over there. Then I dropped down time frames and I said, okay, well, price closed below that structure. Once we close below, we add a fib from our high to our low. So everyone will be selling here. We know we're going to be selling at point of confluence. Okay. So then we actually just add our level there. We'll also have the psychological level 69250. So that's basically what I was looking for. I don't usually like trend lines, so I'll just take that out. I'll take that out. That was the only position that I was looking for. So it's basically just eliminating slowly but surely. The only thing that will tell me to enter will be candlestick patterns. So perfect morning star candle there and a evening star formation as well. So just after that candle, short position somewhere in that range, stop loss just above that, and then you can actually just add your TPs. So another way you can add your take profits is obviously just adding that fib and then knowing that -0.38 and -0.61. So that's basically the trade we were looking for this week ahead. So what I will obviously usually do is once I take that sell, I'll still have a sell order ready on that level as well. So if it does end up pushing up, we'll just trigger that sell perfect 1-11 and then push down. But we still ended up doing a 1-5 risk reward. So if you were risking 1%, you would have made just over 5%, or let's just say 5% on that trade. Very simple trade over there. Then CHFJPY, there wasn't actually entries. What we said on the Supply Sunday video is price broke structure to the top side. So we knew we're looking for buys. Remember, once again, most retail are going to end up buying from there. We know that we add a fib and we look for point with the most confluence. So if we go to the left hand side, we're going to see that buying level over there on the 61. Then we'll add that area of demand. Over there, just push that forward. And just through that, actually, we know obviously what we're looking for that buy to the top side. So that was obviously the week before, but that obviously tells us what we're doing for the long term. So let's quickly jump back to the higher time frames. So here we knew, okay, well, if price buys from there, we're going to be looking to moving into that direction. So there wasn't actually entries on this for me personally. I only use this for confluence, knowing that I'm looking for buyers on JPY, EURJPY, etc. So what I would have seen is a break of structure there, would have added my fib, but would have never gotten a pullback at any time. So for me personally, there wasn't the trade on the specific pay, but we knew long term that JPY is going up. So a correlation would have worked out. Then dollar index obviously had that break of structure to the top side. Once we break above, we just add our fib and we have pullback to the place of buying levels. 38% fib, 0.1, 0.2, 0.3, highest probability. Candlestick patterns, look at that morning star formation, perfect pin bar as well, bullish engulfing candles, multiple confluences for us pushing to the top side. So that will indicate UJSD selling, EURUSD selling. UJSD selling, then Euro UTS buying, GBP UTS buying. Okay. EURUSD also selling, GBP USD also selling. So just a little bit of a confluence over there, USD CAD buying, USD JPY buying, etc. So just by looking at that, such if JPY was buying, DXY was buying, I don't trade this pair, but what was flying through the roof most probably? USD JPY. Don't know where it is even. Here we go. So this was obviously flying through the roof. Oh, I did actually explain it to someone. So the reason this was flying through the roof is because of dollar index buying and CHF JPY buying. I don't trade that pay for personal reasons, but yeah, that was what was happening. Okay, so now we knew that OGSD was selling. We knew we were looking for a buy on Euro order. So we can see here was the start of the week. Price broke, structure to the top side. So we had a big support, area of support over there. And we would have had a demand zone over there. So you could have actually had that buy. That's literally a perfect reversal candle. Market spiking lower, pushing up. Okay, so once again, what I'll always do is I'll have a buy ready over there. Stop loss a little bit bigger. Remember, it is a bigger stop loss, but with pip count being 0.68 or 0.72, depending on which broker you're using, stop loss will actually not be that big. It's a perfect trade over there. But then you could have obviously seen, for me, this is how my approach will look. Price broke structure to the top side. What do? We had our FIB from low to high, and then we start seeking confluence. Okay. Number one or number two, you could have traded the normal trend line breakout strat where it's like price break structure to the top side and a pullback and then a buy to top side. Okay. So what I saw was obviously that level over there. I knew that the market will come to the trend line to actually come and grab those buyers as well. So what I was waiting for is a break back above that level for the buy. So I saw that perfect spinning bottoms spiking to actually exactly the psychological level of 1,500. So I was basically just collecting those buy orders there. So then when price closed above, all I did was just add my FIB, and I knew that I'm going to be looking for buys at the 61, 71, and 78. So basically just using that shorter time frame strategy that I always have, where it stops us below that, buy order day, and then a buy order day. So it would have triggered about a 1 to 12. So one thing you can actually also do is trade some continuation. So the one thing we can actually see is that once price is above this level, it buys to the top side. Multiple reasons why. We can also see the psychological level coming into play. So what you could have done is just drop down 30 minutes. And then as soon as price close above, then you can actually just take buy as well. That was actually my first trade that I took. For those of you that do follow me on any social platform, I actually saw that was the first trade that I took. Once price closed above, I just took the buy to the top side. And then with the pullback, I was looking for the continuation. So multiple entries over there. Then EURGBP isn't actually something that I was looking for personally. It did play out pretty well. So beginning of the week, I sent out this trade over here, sent out that trend line buy, which played out perfectly. Multiple reasons why. So yes, we do have the buying level over there. And we do have the area of demand over there. But we do have so many confluences at that point. Okay, we have the 78 FIB. We have the psychological level of 88250. But there was just more confluence pointing towards that point. So price just went spiked out a lot of buyers, taking out the 088 level exactly over there. Literally just price taking out retail. And then from there, we just had a big push to the top side. So would have had something like that in your bias. Pretty simple trade, candlestick wise as well. We had that perfect rejection, hangman candle on the bottom of the trend. So yeah, pretty good indication for the buys over there, and a pretty good execution as well. So let's quickly jump to 1H just to see what was actually happening there. Yeah, not a lot actually happening there, but we had some rejections already there. So a big chance that a lot of people would have been entering earlier. Myself, I also entered earlier. I entered on those candlesticks and I just had a stop below that spike because of the psychological level and the trend line. And I actually just took that trade to the top side. So it wasn't the best trade. But the nice thing is I actually had a counter trade in, like I always do. I had a buy limit set. So when it spiked down, activate that order. When it pushed to break even, I closed that trade and I was just running that position to the top side. The nice thing is then you can literally exit there and still have a 1-to-3 risk reward ratio. So the initial entry wasn't too great. I think it was just obviously me being a little bit impatient and waiting for this market for quite a few days. And then I just entered and yeah, luckily just got the counter trade as well. Then already knew we were selling USD. So all we had to do is just figure out where. Okay. So starting over here, break of structure to downside, started selling. New week started here. Okay. So what did we do? All we had to do is just add our fib from previous high to low. Identify goal. Previous support becoming resistance in this instance. 0.75 psychological level. But there would have been more towards the 7750. And see the market's been trading from the quarter levels quite quite a lot actually. But then we had that 4 hour perfect evening star formation. But I would have obviously been watching the 1 hour. So what I would have been doing is actually looking at there to the left-hand side, we can actually see price sales from there. So we can see the multiple rejections, hangman candles in the middle. So I would have most probably shorted the market somewhere in that region. I had a stop loss above that level over there. So there's a big opportunity. I don't take this trade personally, because there was just more or better opportunities. But there's a big chance that you would have gotten stopped out of this position. So for me, what I would have done is sold there and I would have had a sell order there. But yeah, like I said, most probably would have gotten spiked out at this position. So that's just one of those trades where you get spiked out and then price actually goes your way. Didn't do anything wrong. It was just a spike from the news coming out, taking you out. That was the CPI news actually. So just taking out, doing a little bit of a liquidity grab, and then as soon as that's done, price actually just drops to the downside. That's why I mostly stay away from news, especially the fact that I know there's so many good technical trades. So I would have waited till after the news, most probably before entering. But in the case where a news event does take you out, don't change your bias because of a news event. So a lot of time it just takes people out in a selling market. So already in a selling market, so just stick to your bias and re-enter. Okay. I already said that you'd be always buying before we even got here. The reason for that is, well, USD was selling. Bigger correlation to the Australian dollar than to the pound, you'd be always. There's no reason for it. It's just how it is. So after years of studying, I figured this out that GBP odd is well, one of the only pound pairs that correlates more to the quad currency. So pretty much same thing. Could have added your trend line, whatever it might be. Everyone will have the different strategies, breakout, retest, buy. But in the end, it comes down to the same thing. Okay, so we had a support, we had 0.74, and all you had to do is just add your fib from previous low to high. 78 fib being the last resort fib, you would have gotten a good entry. Even if you added it there, you would have had a 61 fib there, and over there, you would actually have a 38% fib. That's why I always say it doesn't actually matter where you put your fib. Then the only thing was candlestick patterns. That is a textbook spinning bottoms. Yeah. British engulfing candle, and there's the reed test, and there is the bottom. So would have most probably entered on that reed test. So a lot of people always ask me, like, how would you have entered on that reed test if there was actually it just tapped and went? Because that was already my indication that we're buying. So if I missed that move, I would just enter as soon as it gets to the zone. And then once again, just use my thing where it's like, well, there's a spike, so I'm going to add a buy there. There's a spike, so I'm going to add a buy there. Price dips lower, I buy again. Price dips even lower, I buy again. So it would have triggered about, yeah, one, two trades, or two of my trades. So pretty good decent trade over there as well. GPJPY, we knew we were buying just due to the fact of what was happening. So I did see a break of structure to the top side, and I did what I always did, always do. But this wasn't for me, because I saw that, but then I looked back and I said, okay, well, the buying levels are there. So I'm not going to buy from the 38% FIB. That's why I moved it to there. I was like, well, that makes more sense. Then I saw the psychological level of 160, and I was like, well, let's look for a buy from there. So it never got to my position. That's once again, I won't move my levels just because I'm not getting the trade. Then GU, I've been saying we're gonna sell this the whole time. Because we've been targeting this area since like 2 weeks back, all the way from that top. I said there's no buying levels in the middle. We need to move to that levels. So we do have this minor level over there. But for price to start going up again, we will come visit this major level over here. Okay. Also not a trade that I was looking at. So we had that high low, took out the high low, had a pullback and a sell from the 61. But it was just a spike during the CPI news. So probably wouldn't have gotten that trade. So there was no trade personally for me on the specific pair. Could have added the trade. You can see there's some selling pressure there. If price closed below, could have added the trade there as well. But for me personally, there wasn't a trade. This is probably the best trade for the week. I took this trade as well. I explained on supply Sunday that we had a left shoulder head, right shoulder, or third, such as you want to see it. We also have psychological level of 133. So basically what I did was I added my fib. Could actually just move it to the 78, but in the end it won't actually matter. Then I had a bigger area of demand because it is a key level. So once again, sometimes you are going to have a bigger level. Then price came down with the news. Once again, just had a little bit of a spike, and that was a perfect indication for me for a buy. But I didn't jump in because it was during the news. So what I saw then was left shoulder ahead, right shoulder. And as soon as I had a break of structure to top side, all I had to do is just add my fib, wait for that, and then look at that perfect spinning bottoms. And then I took a buy position over there. So stop loss below that. And I had another buy order lined up over there. So it didn't trigger, but that was the setup that I took. This is out. I haven't been actually looking at this. This thing is just going into one direction. I only trade this long term, so I didn't have an update on this. Well, also didn't have an update on this. I didn't even look at it. Price action is very messy. For me, I usually just open the market, and if I see a price action being very unclear, very messy, I just usually leave it. I don't try and rush into two things too much if I don't see where it's going. Then gold, we're looking for a sell. So we had that area of demand, break of structure to the downside. And then last week, we're looking for that sell from a 38% FIB. Once again, could have added multiple technicals for that trade. And then we're actually looking to push down. So now let's drop to the lower time frames. So yeah, there wasn't a lot for me to work on because there's no clear area of support. It was more trending towards the downside. So from there, I didn't actually look. I didn't look for something there or anything. So there wasn't a clear trade for me after what happened there. Could have maybe looked for a pullback trade. I will never advise a pullback trade. I always take the trend trade. But yeah, could have actually been looking for something like that. So that's pretty much it when it gets to the currencies. So let's get into indices. Indices was, yeah, actually a pretty clean week for me personally. So what I did this week, I saw we have a key level here at the bottom. We have a key level there at the top, and then we have multiple smaller minor levels in the middle. So what I actually did was I just marked off, especially if you have so many buying levels, just marked off everywhere where price is buying and selling. So what I did was price broke above there with the news, and it's created a higher high. And as soon as we came back, I knew that I'm going to be looking for a buy over there. Okay, that's the buy that I sent out on for the week. Then market went up towards the top side, then rejected. So I actually just changed my bias. I'm not very biased when it gets to indices. I basically just trade what I see. Then I was looking for that trade over there. That was the cleaner trade because there was actually some good candlestick patterns. So now at the bottom, the thing was for me, it's like, well, there is buying pressure there, there's buying pressure there. So all I did was just add multiple entries once again. So I had a little bit of a bigger SL. I didn't enter at the top one because price just went straight to the bottom one. And then I had a little bit of entry lower. There we go. I had a little bit of entry lower looking at that. And that was the target. It's over here. Okay, that's the target we have there because that's where price sells from. If we look back now, we'll also see some selling pressure there. And then I had a buy there and a buy order placed there. So that was basically the buy position that I was looking at. Then NASDAQ, pretty much same thing. Let me just take that out. We had a key level over there. We had a key level over there. And then we had some buying levels over there. So price went bought from there to there. Would have entered there for a little bit of a while. Look at that Morningstar formation, hangman candle on bottom of trend. Then we had the pullback and another buy. So I always just mark off all the selling and buying levels. You can also see that selling levels over there. So that was basically if we don't break above that, then we know we'll have a drop off. And then now we're just buying on those buying levels. So the key to trading indices is, for me, this is a personal experience, is looking to scale into almost any trade. So if I take this buy up to there, so that's what I would be looking at. But most probably, if that thing drops like that, I'll get out. So if I'm risking 1 to 6, okay, then that means that I'm gonna, let's say I'm risking 100 rand, I'm making 600 rand. Okay. So now I take that out, price is moving up. At this point, I won't be seeing that level over there. When we have a pullback, then I'll be looking for buy over there. So pretty much same thing. I'll be looking for another buy. Obviously, I'll still add my FIB and those things because FIB will be the reason for the spike to the 61 FIB. So then I'll be taking that trade again. And then we push into the highs. So for me, there's no rejection there. There's no clear candlestick confirmation for me to take the entry. But then we drop lower, and then I would have been looking for another trade over there. So what I'll actually do is I'll keep buying and buying and buying and buying. So there's the buying level, so we'll place that. Then I'll take another buy over there. With that multiple spinning tops there, I'll actually exit the trade. Okay. So you can actually take that trade now back to the downside. Okay, and then obviously looking for a scale in again over there. So now if price pushes up to this week, let's look where we have selling levels. We only have selling levels a day. Okay, a day. So now what we can do is just add another cell. So it's basically based on taking more entries. So still being smart with it, but taking more entries. Already know it, on the bigger time frames we're trading in this range. And then just taking multiple entries. Because the thing is, if you're risking the constant same amount, same amount, same amount, every time you win like five, six times your risk. And every time you lose 1%. So there was like three or four trades that we could have actually gotten into. So let's say with the 1, 2, 3 risk reward event, we're risking 100 rand, so it's 369, 1,200 rand up. So the time we lose, we're literally still up 1,100 rand. So it's about trusting yourself, having a clear risk management plan. With indices, risk management plan and a trading plan is the key element. All right. Thanks for watching, guys. And then I'll see you guys next week. Cheers.
Thank you.